Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Hi, and welcome to the Fort Report. I am Kevin Leininger from the News-Sentinel, and with me tonight is Kevin Knuth, spokesman for the Allen County Democratic Party, John McGauley, Republican Allen County Recorder. They were here a couple of weeks ago to give their predictions about the election, which we have now had. So I brought you back to find out if you really are as smart about politics as everybody thinks you are. Which one of you would like to take credit for being closest to the truth?
Wow,
I think
worded it that way, it's a little bit different. You know, it's a real mixed bag, I think. I think we both called some races right and some wrong, so it's really hard to say. In this case, you know, I said Tom Henry would win re-election. I was right. Mm-hmm. I said Sandy Kennedy would win. I was right. I thought Karen Goldner would win. I was wrong.
Mm-hmm. So 2 out of 3, you know, that'll get you in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, not quite where I wanted to be, though.
Now, John, you did predict Paula Hughes, I believe, and Zach Bonahoom, who you worked for in the campaign. What happened?
Well, you know, I think I predicted that Zach had a chance. Mm-hmm. That's as far as I'm willing to go. The interesting thing is, as I said, it was going to be Hughes by 3.5 points. And I think the spread was pretty close, which says some things that I think we'll talk about later. It was, you know, 3.5, 4 points. I did predict Rush Yale out in the second district. I did predict John Crawford in the at-large. I didn't predict Crawford. I predicted him losing. And he came back and finished pretty strongly.
Well, let's start with the Crawford race. Why do you think, given the controversy he had 4 years ago with the smoking issue, what put him over the top this time?
You know, I think that there was some buyer's remorse from the people that kicked him out last time. You know, the smoking ordinance has had a chance to take effect, and some people have seen what the actual impact of it is. But, you know, there was some buyer's remorse, especially among the conservatives, among the Republicans, you know, turning loose somebody who was such a strong fiscal conservative.
I think it might be simpler than that, actually. I think it was all name recognition. John Schoaf and Marty Bender, strong name recognition. And Crawford, frankly, just had more name recognition than Freistroffer. And Freistroffer's ran 3 times. He's finished 4th. In every race, he just cannot quite get over the hump, and I think Crawford's name is stronger. The guy spent a lot of money, advertised on television, and he got his name out
there.
Well,
he did. He spent over, what, $100,000,
right? Yeah, and I think the anger over the smoking ban, for the most part, has waned somewhat. Mm-hmm. Unless you're a really hardcore smoker right now, you're probably pretty thankful you can't smoke in a restaurant or a bar.
Well, John, before we leave that, Bonahoom did outdraw, actually, Paula Hughes. What, if anything, do you make of that?
You know, I think that it had a lot to do with the mayor's race, you know. And Zach did do a real good job of raising money and getting out there and getting his name out there, positively and negatively in some cases. And it's remarkable. It's the first time that I've been able to find in the numbers in the past election results where the clerk candidate actually outdrew the mayor's candidate. And I think that was remarkable. I think that spoke a lot to the strength of what he did.
Well, is it him, and we can get it into now the mayoral campaign and the ads, but is it him being strong or Paula Hughes and her campaign being weak, do you think? Kevin, why don't you start?
I'm not even going to blame just Paul. I think both mayoral campaigns basically turned out their base. And, you know, Paula Hughes, I think we discussed before the show started taping, probably spent somewhere between $600,000 to $800,000 in his campaign and got 400 more votes than Matt Kelty, who was facing 7 felony indictments. It just tells you the hardcore base came out and voted for, and a hardcore base came out and voted for Tom Henry, and the people who were missing this election were the independents. And I think a lot of people went to the voting booths and just said, you know what, I'm not voting for either mayoral candidate because they didn't like the tone of the campaign. So between not liking the tone of the campaigns, we lost some votes there from both races, and besides the fact that, you know, it's just one of those election years where you're not sure what's going to happen in Northeast Indiana, because we've had some goofy elections that we're not going to talk about, but area-wide, you go to several counties around us, some Democrats got elected in Huntington County. These things just don't normally happen.
Mm-hmm. We beat people into submission in this race, in particular in the mayor's race. 73% of voters stayed home on Tuesday, and that's not because they were bored or lazy or something like that. That's because the negativity just beat them into submission. It's been a long time since we had a mayor's race that was this close. The last couple have been, you know, blowouts to one degree or another. And the fact that this was separated by, you know, 4 points, maybe a little bit above, showed that they barely got their base out.
I would say there's one caveat to that whole thing, though, too. This is only the second election with a Boyd annexation taking effect. Mm-hmm. And those numbers, when you say percentage of registered voters, you know, we don't always purge voters. You know, 20 years ago, we'd purge voters. If you didn't vote, I think it was 3 consecutive mm-hmm. elections, you were purged from the rolls, you had to go re-register to vote. We don't do that anymore on that regular basis. Mm-hmm. So you end up with a lot of people who are registered to vote who have no intention of voting. So there certainly was less voters this time, but when you look at the percentages, I'm not so sure it's as dramatic as some people think.
Well, you mentioned a Boyd, though, and it's perceived as a heavily Republican right. territory. Sheriff Ken Fries, among others, mentioned that he thought turnout in a Boyd was very light, as it was everywhere. Is that a direct indication that the base really was not all that energized about Paula Hughes, do you think?
You know, in 2003, we were really counting, you know, and I was the candidate for city clerk that year, we were really counting on the DuPont Road annexation to come out big time for Buskirk, and they didn't. You know, I don't think these annexed areas get as fired up as people think they are about annexation or about, you know, their hardcore base beliefs. You know, eventually that fire wanes in them and they become a part of the city.
I think part of that too, though, is the simple fact that both candidates are perceived. You have a column today in your paper, both candidates seem to be nice people. Mm-hmm. So you don't really have a case to replace Tom Henry. When you have any incumbent, I don't care who it is, you got to have a reason to replace him. And people thought, hey, he's doing a decent job. You just kind of let it go. There was not motivation enough to go after it.
Well, you talk about them being nice, and the point of the column was, yeah, Henry especially is perceived as nice. Paula was more of an unknown, and so maybe the negative campaign tainted her a little bit more. Let's throw some red meat on the table and ask each of you to tell me which candidate you think ran the dirtier campaign and why.
Well, of course, I'm going to say Paula Hughes, but here's why. And I don't think dirtier is fair. I think more misleading campaign. You know, she had several ads where she said that you know, the city of Fort Wayne's lost 14,000 jobs, and that took in 3 counties, not just Fort Wayne. So certainly very misleading facts. I would say that the facts that the Henry campaign used, if you went and researched them, I think they stand up. I would stand behind any of those statements even. I would take that gamble. So I think it's just, but you know, this is spin. This is politics. This is the business side of politics, and some people don't understand that it is not pretty. It gets ugly. It gets dirty. It's not, well, it's kind of fun, but not for other people.
You know, there's a two-sided answer to this. Paula started pretty early with beating up her opponents. There's no argument about that. I mean, this started in the primary. You know, I worked for Eric Doden back in the primary, and you know, I remember very well the mailers that were coming out in March and April. But I think ultimately the campaign that went dirtier, longer, harder, and faster was the Henry campaign. I mean, you come out a week before the election accusing somebody of not paying their taxes when they paid their taxes, it gets pretty tough. I mean, the mailer that came out about Bonahoom was pretty rough. I mean, this guy was one step short of being a wife beater in this ad that came out. This got ugly. I'm going to go ahead and say the Henry campaign went dirty, longer, faster.
Only one step short because he hasn't been married. No, I'm kidding about that. It was a joke.
Well, what about Paula Hughes's threat to file some kind of a litigation over the tax ad? Any legs to that, do you think?
No, not whatsoever. Look, the record's out there, the public record's out there. She was part of a corporation that did not pay its taxes until it went to the sheriff's lien. And so, you know, this business has been closed down for 2 or 3 years. And in August of this year, she finally pays the tax bill. And she says she wasn't really responsible. She was a minority owner. Well, and in an LLC, the way the rules are set up, you are responsible, just that much of a fact. She at least was partially responsible, at the very least, and she's trying to deny that.
All right. Well, let's move on to the...
But I don't think it was a big issue either. I do want to mention, I don't think that was a big issue. What I have heard time and time again since the election was the leaf pickup was the one that did her in.
Whether that was fair or not, I guess...
I know, but it's the one that did her in.
Well, you might be right. Let's move on to the city council and the relationship between the mayor and council as we move ahead. We've gone from a 5-4 Republican majority to a 6-3. Now, will the dynamic change one way or the other in there, do you think?
I don't think a lot. I think that some of the Republicans got elected are pretty pragmatic. John Crawford, for instance, is always willing to, he states his opinion and he believes what he believes, but he's always willing to listen to a good idea and get behind it. And so I think that pretty much you're going to see a council that, that kind of realizes they have to get some things done.
If we're going to talk about the guy on the other side who we like the most, I'm going to say something about Jeff Paddock. Mm-hmm. Jeff Paddock is a very pragmatic guy, a very, you know, somebody who I think, you know, makes you relax just hearing his voice. I don't think you're going to see a lot of these crazy, you know, hyper-partisan dust-ups at the table as long as Paddock's there.
Well, and to that point, we no longer have Liz Brown, and we no longer have Tim Pape, who are...
What are you saying exactly? Well,
you know exactly what I'm saying. So, yeah, even though it's more of a majority, we may actually, in fact, have more cooperation, do you think? Or at least better relations.
Crawford said the other day, though, he made a point that he wants to help the mayor have a good 4 years because he wants Fort Wayne to have a good 4 years. I think it comes down to that. I think, you know, now that the election's over, people have at least a couple years here where we don't have to worry about politics, don't have to worry about the next election cycle, and I think you're going to see a much more cooperative mayor-council for at least 2 years. Then we start getting ready for the next election, it's hard to say what happens.
There's a difference here, I think, when you have a lot of politics at the table versus a lot of philosophy, and I think philosophy will take over in this term, and you'll see a lot more people talking about what they want to do versus, you know, who they want to do in.
Well, speaking of looking ahead, why don't we do that? Why don't we start with Dr. Crawford again? Do you see any movement out of council or even out of him individually to revisit the smoking issue and make it tougher than it already is?
I'm not sure you
can
make
it any tougher in the city. You can't do it anymore.
Sure you could.
I doubt that they'll revisit it and make it any tougher than it currently is. That would really surprise me.
The gains from revisiting that are too small, and the price is going to be too high.
Yeah, I don't think other than maybe him, there probably isn't a lot of support on council for that. What do you think the main issues for the city moving ahead in the next year or two will be?
Well, clearly the light lease fund is the big one. What do we do? Some people suggest that we use it to give people a temporary tax break, although it would be fairly minimal in my opinion. Some people say you have to do something big. I don't know what the answer is. I'm not smart enough, above my pay grade, but it's going to be a big issue before council.
It's going to be scaling government down to what it can afford to be. I don't think we've seen the last of really bad budget years. You know, I'm on the county side these days where things have gotten particularly bad, and I don't think we've seen the worst of it yet. I think it's going to be a lot about just keeping the lights on and keeping basic services flowing.
Well, Kevin, to your point, neither candidate really talked much about the light lease or the capital improvement money, for that matter. Paula talked about drawing down debt, which I don't think excited anyone. Is that something the new mayor and to whatever degree the council got involved should be talking about now, getting the community behind a vision?
Absolutely what we have to, I think that's absolutely where we need to go. Something was interesting said to me by, and I'm not going to name who told it to me, but made this comment right before the election. He said it's funny that we have all these big issues facing Fort Wayne, this light lease money and stuff, and yet this election is going to come down to whether or not the mayor's paid $30,000 more than he should be and how many times we pick up leaves. And ironically, though, that is exactly what this election came to. Those became the two big issues with all the things we're dealing with, which is kind of silly in many ways.
And I think that's why we got so many people just check out this election. But yeah, I think it's going to be important because, you know, you can't make a big dent on taxes. You can't make a big dent on debt with $70 million, but you can make a big dent in everyday people's lives. And it's going to be a big issue. It's also going to be very exciting. It's got a lot of potential to get people engaged in government.
I'll throw you a curveball, but I don't know how much you follow New Haven politics, but we had an interesting development out there with Mayor McDonald, Republican, endorsing two Democrats for council, both of whom lost. And so now we have an all-Republican council in New Haven. Was that a miscalculation on Mayor McDonald's part, do you think? Or was that, from his standpoint at least, a good move?
I know it got a lot of attention. There, you know, a lot of folks, especially other Republican candidates, got particularly interested and fired up about that. It doesn't necessarily surprise me. I mean, you know, Mayor McDonald was originally a Democrat. I mean, he ran his first term as mayor as a Democrat. I mean, he's obviously got some allegiances. He's got some people that he believes in. But I don't think that ever had a chance to really help them out there, because if you think the city of Fort Wayne leans conservative, and you think Allen County as a whole leans conservative, East Allen County, that's where the real conservative base is.
I think that, you know, he did, but he wanted people on council who were going to be helping him, and he thought that those two would help him, as opposed to two people he might think are a little too far to the right and may not help him get the things he wants to get done, is what it comes down to. I don't think it's going to hurt him at all. He is incredibly popular out there. I still wish he was a Democrat, as a matter of fact. He's so popular out there, but he's not, and it's just what we deal with. But I don't think overall it's going to hurt him a lot, but it is interesting to see that happen. It was also interesting to see in Woodburn that, you know, quite frankly, the GOP had a good election night in Allen County. We lost, I believe, 6 seats to the GOP. In the 4 years I was chairman, we took 7 away from the GOP, so in one night, they pretty much wiped out all those gains.
Do you think Fort Wayne is a Democratic town predominantly, or is it still a Republican town that went for Henry for whatever reason?
I think it's mainly independents. And I think there's a certain amount of base on both sides, but there's no way you can explain 16 years of a Democratic mayor when other than, say, Matt Kelty, they have had credible candidates on their side. It's not like they've been nutballs or crazy people. I mean, Linda Buskirk's a very credible candidate. You know, Paula Hughes is a credible candidate. They've had some good people in their primary elections. This is not a fluke. People seem to like the messages, and Democrats have won that office.
Any truth to the argument that gender had anything to do with it? Will some people in Fort Wayne simply refuse to vote for a woman no matter what?
I still think that's a problem. You know, I worked on both of Linda Buskirk's campaigns, and granted, those have been getting, those are a while back now. But, you know, I ran into people, you know, on the streets during those campaigns who in the spring wouldn't vote for Linda because she was a woman, who by the fall had come up with another reason not to vote for her. I don't think that is dead.
I would agree. I did not know currently, but I knew in 1999 at Democratic headquarters, we had people coming in, especially older couples, saying lifelong Republicans, a woman should not be mayor. And it surprises me because, you know, for the record, I voted for Hillary in the primary 2 years ago. So, you know.
Well, do you think that had anything to do with the campaign? I mean, Linda Buskirk, we all know, is kind of a wonk, very intelligent. Didn't run an aggressive campaign, as I recall. It's certainly nothing like we had now. Was Paula Hughes in any way trying to overcompensate for that gender bias, if you want to put it that way?
I don't think it's that. I think that Paula's campaign, just to me, never seemed to be hitting on all cylinders. For example, a couple weeks ago when we did the show, the issue that day, just the day before, she had a press conference about what negative campaigning. Mind you, 2 days later, she released another negative campaign ad. But that was the same day that council was voting on, the same day she had a press conference, council voted on the budget. It was a perfect opportunity to go after Tom Henry on the city budget and to go after Tom Henry on his proposal for a tax increase, which they later amended out. The Henry campaign manager said to me that day, as long as she's talking about this, we're going to win the election.
You know, I think it comes down more to candidates, especially for higher profile offices, listening too much to consultants who have absolutely no idea what community they're working in that week. I don't think somebody who's running their own campaign believes that you can latch on to the mayor makes too much and the city's too far in debt and talk about nothing else for a year and get elected mayor.
In fact, both candidates brought people in from outside
absolutely
to run them, and yeah, maybe that was part of the problem.
Best thing our next mayoral candidate could do would be to stop doing that.
I would disagree. There's a reason you bring him in. I would say from the Democratic side, we have used outside consultants for the last four mayoral races, but we also get them with a lot of local people who kind of help guide those to understand here's how the local campaigns are usually run. Here's what we do locally in Fort Wayne. And so it kind of tempers it down a little bit. An example of that, Tom Henry's first race, remember the picnic commercial with the Henry family? The original script was a bit snarky, and we went back to him and said, some people in the campaign said, that won't play well in Fort Wayne, but we like the concept, maybe we need to change it up a little bit, and with the changes, it became an award-winning commercial.
Well, looking ahead, what kind of mayor will Tom Henry be the next 4 years? Much as we've had, will he be largely kind of a hands-off ceremonial mayor, which is what he has said he considers himself to be, or will he be more of the visionary we talked about?
I think that Tom has a vision. I think a lot of how bold his vision is comes down to what he decides to do in the next 4 years, and he's going to decide if he's going to run again or is he not going to run again. And if you're not going to run again, it's a whole lot easier to be a lot bolder than it is if you're planning on running again.
I think he's told some people that he wants to do one more and go out and teach while he's still young enough to do it. You know, I think he has been as bold as he's ever going to get. You know, I think his you know, attitude here is to be a positive guy who's all about Fort Wayne. But, you know, I think you've seen about as bold as he's ever going to get.
Well, do you both think he'll serve four more years and then leave, or what's your prognosis on that?
I do.
I don't know. I will say that election night, I told Cindy Henry, we'll meet tomorrow at breakfast to discuss his next campaign, and she said, no, we're not. So I think we are. She said, no, we're not. So I'm not sure where we're at with that.
Let's play the game. Let's assume four and out for the mayor. Who's the likely Democratic nominee in 4 years?
Well, don't point at me because it's not going to be me. I'll tell you that up front. I don't know. We have several good people. So I still think Karen Goldner would stand a shot at it. She's a really capable person. I don't think Tim Pape's interested yet, but he would be a good candidate as well. And I would not rule out a guy like Jeff Paddock.
Well, I was going to say, since he hasn't mentioned Jeff Paddock, but that's where I see that going. You know, I wouldn't rule out Karen coming back. I mean, she's got a lot of respect in the party. She's got a lot of respect everywhere. I'm going to say that. Russ may have beaten her, but it wasn't because she, you know, had lost the respect of her constituents. Yeah.
What about on the Republican side?
You know, Tom Didier has said something. Nelson Peters has, you know, expressed an interest within the party in giving that another try. You know, beyond that, I haven't heard a lot of names, but those are the
John McGauley. John McGauley's waiting to see what happens to everybody.
I'm interested, but you know, Nelson. You know, Nelson lost the primary, you know, 4 years ago because of issues beyond his control. And I think that there's still some unfinished business there. I wouldn't be surprised to see him come back.
One other name we heard for a while, and then he went away, but may come back, Sam Tallarico. Is he still a player, do you think, or is he given that up?
I think that he's more interested in doing what he's doing now, spending time with his family, mm-hmm. and quite frankly, he's a very successful attorney. I'm not saying he would never run, but I think some of these attorneys, you know, they can make so much money at a certain age that maybe now is not the time for him to leave his law practice. Yeah. Kind of the same issue I see with a guy like Tim Pape. Maybe when you get to be a little bit older, a little bit wiser, it's okay. At that point in time, you've made a decent amount of money most of your life, and you can go ahead and take the cut of pay that being mayor would be to these guys.
You know, the only time I've seen Sam in the last few years at a political event was introducing Tom Freistroffer when he kicked off his campaign this year. He's not doing the kind of things that you'd see a guy do who wants to stay alive in the party, you know, coming to bean dinners and Lincoln days and things like that. He's not involved in that anymore.
All right, well, we'll maybe start the rumor and see where it goes, right? Why don't we turn our attention in the time we have left to politics outside of Fort Wayne, you know, the national picture. We've got a presidential race going now, coming up in a year. What do you make? Let's start with the Republican side first. That's where all the action is right now. What's going on over there? Who's going to emerge victorious, do you think?
Wow. You know, here's the problem that Republicans really have. They don't have a rock star yet. They need a rock star to win this election. I know Barack Obama's ratings are low in the polls, but you know what? There's not a Republican out there yet who can beat him. Mitt Romney, I think, will end up being the nominee. But most of the base is just not excited by the guy. And this is the real problem the Republican Party has. They have to find that rock star, and they don't have one yet.
We have a rock star who's gradually fading. Herman Cain was our rock star there for a little while. You know, you've seen a lot of these top-notch candidates, the top-tier candidates, mm-hmm. rather, you know, show up in Indiana already trying to get Indiana interested because it went the other way last time. You know, it's hard to say right now. I mean, we're gradually getting down to the point where we're facing the inevitability of Mitt Romney.
And you're right. That doesn't really excite anyone. Do you think, though,
process of elimination.
Is it going to be to the point where the public is anybody but Obama, or do you think the Republicans actually have to, as Kevin says, win it?
I'll tell you, I've seen recently, though, there's been three polls done just last week. One, in fairness, one was not a nationwide poll. It was just done in the state of Florida, where a majority of Americans now believe the GOP is intentionally suppressing the economy just to win the White House. If the Obama administration can sell that, they will win.
You know, I don't believe that voters as a whole will kick out an incumbent just because they want to kick out the incumbent. We've got to put up somebody who's marketable. There for a little while, that was Rick Perry. For, you know, the last few weeks, that's been Herman Cain. We're slowly starting to run down our list of rock stars.
Well, who ever thought Newt Gingrich would make a comeback?
Yeah,
right?
I just heard something this afternoon about Gingrich being in third.
Mm-hmm. What does that tell you?
That we're running out of rock stars.
That tells you they're getting desperate. Yeah. And that's the real problem they face. I'm not saying Obama's not beatable. He's very beatable. If you have the right candidate to beat him, and they don't have him.
And we're way past the point now where somebody could jump into this.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. And who out there would be a rock star? I can't even, you know, Perry or Chris Christie in New Jersey, perhaps, but he's made it clear he's not interested either. Right. So.
Yeah, it really is. It is one of those things where it's just hard to say what's going to happen because nobody seems to be the one who can stay on top long enough. And part of that might be that there's such a demand for party purity that none of these candidates are really exciting enough of the base to really catch on long term.
What's your prediction about the charges against Herman Cain? Will they be proven out, do you think, or are they
They won't
bogus?
Be proven out, but they'll finish him off.
I think they might very well be true, although maybe not. I think they might very well be true, and it doesn't matter. He's already done. Mm-hmm. It's too late.
Unfortunately.
All right, well, we have just a couple of minutes left. Let's talk state politics. governor's race, is that going to be a no-brainer for Pence, or will it be closer than people think?
Well, I would say conventional wisdom says that Indiana is going to swing back to the Republican side, and that would be good for Mike Pence. However, I will tell you this. Outside of the Fort Wayne market, we kind of know Mike Pence, mainly because if you're involved in politics, you know him because of who he was in Congress. But if you're not really involved in politics, in Allen County, you might know him because his district came up here. Mm-hmm. But if you go to other parts of the state, they say, Mike, who? And I can do this little test people all the time. Who's our congressman from the first district? most people cannot answer you because it's not near your district. So he does not have the name recognition some people think he has yet.
It'll be a walk in the primary. But John Gregg in the southern part of Indiana is as well thought of and respected as Mike Pence is, you know, in the parts of Indiana where he's strong.
Yeah, I think it's going to be closer than people think it does. It will not surprise me. It does not surprise me if Pence wins, but I think it might be closer than people think it's going to be.
Can Obama take Indiana next year one way or the other?
I think it'll be very difficult for him to take it next time.
Same here. I don't think so.
Okay.
So unless they put up another really bad candidate, because they sure did last time.
Well, yeah, I don't think the Republicans are all that excited about any of their choices. So we'll see. Any final thoughts from you guys about looking forward to 2012? What's going to be the big political story in Fort Wayne, do you think?
Well,
write the headline for me.
I think it's probably going to be the fact that Obama wins Fort Wayne, but who knows? It's just too early to tell what's going to happen in 2012.
I don't know what he did in 2008, but the county as a whole was the only big urban county in Indiana that went for McCain.
That's true.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you both very much. John McGauley, Allen County Recorder. Kevin Knuth, Democratic former chairman and current spokesman. I appreciate you both coming in, and maybe we can do it all again next year as the political season hits up. And thank you all for joining us for the Fort Report tonight. I'm Kevin Leininger, and I encourage you to check us out on our website at the News Sentinel, www.news-sentinel.com. Don't forget the hyphen. And on behalf of John McGauley, Kevin Knuth, and myself, thank you for joining us.